All right, Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 says, now the serpent, that is also the devil. Okay, you can see that happen, or the terminology shift take place in the book of Revelation. But that's talking about the devil. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. Notice the word subtle doesn't look like it does in modern English. That's because it's not the same word. Okay, but subtle for you means crafty, sneaky, tricky. That didn't go over very, very big. He's not talking about you or me. He's talking about the devil. Go ahead, and he is sneaky. He is tricky. Hallelujah. All right, so the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, listen to this and watch this very closely. Yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. So that's kind of like a lead-in statement. Now remember, it's Eve that he's talking to. Okay, it's been said, and it should be understood that Satan had, Adam had dominion in the garden. Remember, God gave, and Adam is the one who let Satan start talking. That should have been stopped. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, you can go ahead and say amen. But what people do, unfortunately, just like Adam, they try to blame it on the women. So we're just going to parse it out correctly here. You know, she was the one that they were, I would say they were susceptible, both of them. Because you can remember, Adam took it too. Okay, but meaning that they were both susceptible, able to be deceived. Hallelujah. And so Satan took advantage of them, which he does. And if you let him, he's going to take advantage of you. He does not have mercy. He doesn't take an inch and stop. He takes an inch and goes a mile. And then you have to kick him out. You learn how to be salty when you're dealing with the devil. You cannot be weak or sweet or kind. Come on now, go ahead and say amen. All right, so Satan leads Eve in. Verse 2 says, the woman said unto the serpent, she should have never done this, but we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, he hath said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Now, you can just go right back to the second chapter and see that Eve added something. Now, so the devil, like he saw, okay, now's there's my open door. She's not only susceptible, but she's ill-informed. Oh, go ahead and say amen. The serpent said unto her, you shall not surely die. That was the first lie. God said, you will die. In the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. Satan counters that directly. And then verse 5, for God does know, this is him still talking, God does know that in the day that you eat thereof, then shall your eyes be open. Now that does happen when you get saved. But at the point with Adam, his eyes were already open. Your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Hallelujah. Now, that's a lie. Praise the Lord. And so what we want to do is learn something about Satan's lying. Go with me, if you would, over to the Gospel of John chapter 8. Jesus is going to teach us something here. This is real blunt. You know, in today's world, a lot of times when you roll this kind of truth out, it seems strong to people. And then that's because of what's happened to mankind. But Jesus is being kind. He is kind. Hallelujah. But look in Gospel of John chapter 8. Verse 44, he does not mince any words. Praise the Lord. He's talking to the scribes and Pharisees. He says, you are of your father, the devil. Now remember, he's talking to them, not you. Amen. You are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Hallelujah. So Satan is a liar. Now today we want to draw a little distinction between lying, praise the Lord, and being a liar. So Jesus called Satan a liar. Okay, he is a liar. And then there are lies. Okay, so people who are not liars slip up and say things that are not true. Sometimes they don't even know it. All right, we're going to show you some distinctions about that in the Word that's going to help you today. Hallelujah. Okay, but Jesus said that Satan is a liar. Now, the reason why that statement is like that is because of Satan's nature. He is a liar by nature. Hallelujah. Now go with me, if you would please, to Romans chapter 8. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is good. Wonderful thing happened to you when you made Jesus the Lord of your life. So let's get ourselves identified here. How many of you are saved? Raise your hand like this, and it's going to be the predominance of you. If you're not saved, at the end of this service, you can pray with us and accept Jesus as your Savior. But if you are saved, raise your hand up like that. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You should be bold. Hallelujah. That's your faith that's raising your hand. Let's do it again. Are you saved? Hold your hand up in the air. You're not ashamed of who you are in Christ Jesus. And I like to say, wow, if you're afraid to raise your hand identifying yourself in church, come on, let's do it again. Are you saved? I mean, you either are or you're not. There we go. Okay. That it is plain. Isn't that plain? Make it plain. We're going to write it down. Write the vision. Make it plain. So they that read it may run with it. Hallelujah. All right, now look, if you would, at verse 9 of Romans chapter 8. It says, but you are not in the flesh. Now he's talking to Christian people. Let's see, are you a Christian person? Raise your hand. All right, now just keep your hand up. Look at your hand. He's talking to you. It's your hand, right? Well, he says, you're in the spirit. You're not in the flesh, you're in the spirit. Look at your hand. This is called positional truth. You are in the spirit. Biblical terminology, are you out there? You are in the spirit. You're not in the flesh. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, he goes on and explain, if you're born of God. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So when you accept Jesus as your Savior, you're automatically in the Spirit. Go ahead and raise your hand again. Are you on board? There we go. All right. Now, so what that means is that you have been given a new nature. So it's not in your nature to lie. And you're certainly not a liar. Now, you might have been before you got saved, but that was the reason why you accepted Jesus. Born into the kingdom, your nature has been changed. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus, and now you are in the Spirit. God is good. Okay, so go with me over to Ephesians chapter 4. That's called positional truth. There's also the practical side of it. Okay, so we're going to talk about practicality here for just a minute. Look at in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. He says that if you put off concerning the former conversation, the old man. Now we're going to draw a little thing over up here. And hallelujah. It's going to be just a little illustration line like this. Okay, over on this side, we're going to put truth. And over here, we're going to put lies. Okay? Now, we're just going to call this the dividing line. It's the new birth. Hallelujah. Now, we've been delivered. When you got saved, you raise your hand. Let's raise your hand again. There you go. Okay, so what happened to you is you were on this side of the line, and Jesus called this the world. Okay? And over here, we are called the kingdom. Amen. You've been delivered out of the power of darkness, translated into the kingdom of his dear son. So when you got saved, you were moved from this side to this side. Now, let's go ahead and get this settled. See, the world has all these names and titles and groups and things that you ought to fit into, and you're trying to figure out what your identity is. Well, you're not on this side. You're called by the name that is above every name. That's your identity. This is who you are in him. All right, so if you are here with the new nature, what he's saying in Ephesians chapter 4 is, okay, you got it. You got the new nature. Now we need to act like it. Amen. Then you act out, the way you do that is you act out of the inner man. The new man on the inside of you acts through the outer man. Hallelujah. You put off the old man, he's calling it. Are you there? Former conversation, that means old lifestyle, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Now remember, Jesus said that over on this side, which is the lying side, the devil side, you need to just go ahead and chalk it up. The devil, it's his nature to lie. He is a liar. And there is no redemption for him. Now, he never was part of the family of man. But forget about trying to be nice to the devil. You know, I know some Christians, they're so nice and they're so sweet that they, you know, want the devil to get saved. He's not going to. I mean, there's some things that are just not going to change. And that's one of them. The blood of Jesus was not shed for the devil. He's a fallen angel. And his doom is sealed. Go ahead and adjust yourself to it. No point in being nice. You didn't have anything to do with it. Love righteousness and hate iniquity. Hallelujah. So we're over here now. We were over here, but we've been moved. Let's do it again. How many of you have been moved? Raise your hand. There you go. Okay, you see what you're doing? You're identifying yourself with the truth. Now Jesus said, Father, your word is truth. For the record, this might sound a little blunt for some people, but if it's not God's word, it's over here on this side. See, so this, the line of man, praise the Lord. So people that are using all this language, it comes from that fallen nature. God is good. Let's keep going. He says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind that you put on the new man. Now, they're already saved. He's talking to them as Christians. So they've been saved. But he said, now we're going to act like it. Woo, come on, are you out there? How many of you are still saved? Come on, raise your hand. Amen. Now, we're going to act like it now. There's a joke behind, are you still saved? But I'll save that for later. It takes too long to tell it. That you may put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Wherefore, or because of all this, because of who you are in Christ Jesus, wherefore put away lying. All right, so now that I'm saved, I'm not going to be choosing any language or stories or identities or any of these. None of this from this side is going to be in my vernacular. All right, now let's talk a little bit about the word side, the truth side. This is so true. God's word is true. It's so true that all things are upheld by the word of his power. Meaning that God, out of the inside of himself, spoke and he, for instance, he said, "Let there be light." Now you and I have never known anything but light. You live in the dominion of light. Now what we call dark is not actually dark because light is still here. How many of you are out there? So when God said, "Let there be light," it's still ruling because his word is true. Hallelujah. Now, what we do, we come into the kingdom and we go, "Oh, gee, first of all, I got to stop saying those things that are not true. Then instead of all that, I'm going to, instead of calling myself poor, I'm going to say what the word says, that I've been made rich. Instead of calling myself sick, I'm going to change kingdom language. By his stripes, I'm healed." The more word you get in you, the closer you get to this place where you're calling things into existence. Amen. Calling the will of God into existence in your life. God is good. Okay, so go with me over to James chapter 3. I'm going to let you off the hook just a little bit here with this passage. Hallelujah. God is good. He knows that we're frail. How many of you realize that God is nice? He recognizes the frailty of man. He knows what he's dealing with when he's dealing with us. Okay, are you out there? All right, so my brethren, which includes the sister in two, be not many masters. Now that's old English for teachers. All right. Now, so once we cross this line here, we become a purveyor of truth. The extent to which you influence other people's lives, that's what he's calling a teacher. You should be a discipler of men. The Great Commission, come on, are you out there? So all of us are called to do that. Now, he says that knowing if you're one of us, we shall receive the greater correction. The word condemnation is there, but it's just really not translated well. What he's saying is your words are going to have an effect on you. If you're saying the wrong thing to God's people, it's going to backfire on you. That's the reason why he said in Ephesians, stop lying to each other. Because you're all members one of another. So way back here, when we first get saved, we're going to say, all right, well, I'm done with lying. Because you're still going to remember how to lie. So you're going to get your mind renewed. I'm not a liar. I have a new nature. So here we go with lying. It's out. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, really big things happen for believers when they do that, because what you're doing by choosing one way to speak over the other way, you're cutting yourself off from Satan and his lies. See, as long as you're still talking this, you might as well just open up your door and say, all right, Mr. Devil, come on in. Bring all your stuff. Are you out there? So, you know, this is what he said about the greater correction comes. See, you begin to realize, okay, well, I can't just go around and be talking all this negative stuff anymore. I can't identify myself with all these groups. Because what's going to happen to me is I'm going to end up reaping what they're reaping. Ooh, there's people out there just because they're on Facebook. Come on now. Just because they're on social media, you do not want to name yourself. Oh, I feel that way. No, actually you don't. That's the old man talking. Because you got a new nature, and where you identify with who you are is over here in the kingdom. Oh, see, it got quiet all of a sudden in here, real quiet. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. All right, so look at the next verse, verse 2. He says, "For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect," or a mature man, a complete man. All right, so what we're doing is we're learning how to talk kingdom. It's a new language. We're learning how to talk God. Amen. Now, just a little insight for you. You can get all the way over here, but you're as much word as you get in you, you're still not going to be calling stars into existence, at least not yet. I mean, that might be out there in the future beyond the resurrection. Are you there? You can dream that up if you want to. Praise the Lord. But for right now, we got enough. You talk kingdom and you're going to have kingdom. Okay, so we're getting over here like this. Hallelujah. And if you talk kingdom and feed the word in your spirit, then you're going to be getting to the place where you say, all right, I'm only taking healing and blessing into my, I do not accept sickness and disease into my life anymore. Amen. See, and so then that is creative speaking. It's within the context of the New Testament promises. God didn't promise you to give you the moon. That's not in the book. Are you out there? Okay, so that is the limitation. The only limitation on our kingdom speaking is it's the will of God for you. Okay, now, for the record, when we get to the end of this age and God says, all right, it's time to change things again, hallelujah, the same way that everything is held in place by the word of his power right now, all he's got to do is change one little statement. And boom, everything changes again. Are you out there? Now, good thing is you and I are going to be in a preserved place. It's kind of like the flood. You know, God told Noah to build the ark. They got in the ark along with the animals, and then he did one thing that released the powers of the water, which is all still here. Are you there? Okay. So, but God, the preservation of seed, we rode above the waters. So Jesus is our ark. It's okay. We're going to ride above it all. Hallelujah. But there are some things coming that are beyond you and me. I'm glad about that. I don't mind God being bigger than me. I don't mind admitting it. See, this was the thing. Satan was really tempting Adam with this thing about you can be like him. All right, well, I tell you what, go ahead. But I think I'm satisfied with being a child of God. It's okay, you know, it's enough. I'm bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh. I'm seated with Christ in heavenly places. That's good enough for me. I'm not interested in trying to take his place. See, that's that root of evil. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is good. Blessed be the name. That's good, isn't it? Isn't that good? All right, so don't be afraid of the devil. You know, call it what it is. A lie is a lie. But believers do need to disassociate themselves from all of that negative talking and get over here on the kingdom side, and let's go this direction. Let's go towards the truth. Let's get the word coming out of our mouth in abundance. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Glory to the King. God is good. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Going to ask you to stand to your feet. Praise the name of Jesus. The Lord is good. Hallelujah. You've been helping to win souls to the Lord by this altar call that we've been doing lately. It's only been a few months. Hallelujah. But we have continual evidence that people are getting saved. First of all, right here in this room. You know, if you're not saved, just pray along with us. You'll get saved. Now, with me, I have to tell you, I got saved and I didn't know that's what happened to me. I didn't even have the terminology. I was dumb. So I was explaining to this person what happened to me, and she said, well, oh, you got saved. And I said, well, I wouldn't go so far as to say that. I had no idea what that meant or, you know. Hallelujah. Are you out there? So people get saved in an environment like this all the time. Are you following me? This is what we're saying. Hallelujah. Whereas, you know, sometimes it's like setting a trap. Well, the trap would have never gotten me in church. I got saved in my living room. So people are watching this right in their living room, and they're going to get saved right where they're sitting. Woo, and there's people in this room that are going to get saved. Hallelujah. And we're going to lead them along the way. Meanwhile, while you're calling yourself a Christian, wow, you're going to have a realization. That is me, isn't it? Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. You're going to catch up. See, if you say it enough, your head, which is not the smartest part of you, your head will catch up and go, oh, that's right. That is me now. Hallelujah. Now, the smartest part of you is right here. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is good. This is just a, yeah, hallelujah. It's an organ. All right, let's raise our hands like this. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Say this with me, Lord Jesus. I believe in my heart that you are raised from the dead. I say that you are Lord. With my mouth, I confess that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord Jesus, wash me in your blood. Cleanse me of all sin. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for giving me dominion over the works of darkness. I say that Satan is beneath my feet. Sin is beneath my feet. The works of darkness are beneath my feet. I've been delivered. I am now a kingdom person. Thank you, Jesus, for my freedom and my deliverance. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Love on a couple of folks. Bless somebody and tell them you're really glad that you came to church today. Praise God. Don't forget tonight, worship service.